Good evening, good evening, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I welcome you warmly to Grace Hill Bible University's masterclass, Overcoming Hurdles in Marriage, Building It Stronger. And this end of semester masterclass will be presented by the students of the Master's Counseling Degree Program of Grace Hill Bible University, St. Martin Campus. Please feel free to post your name in the chat and let us know where you're joining us from. So I'm gonna ask the students to also just connect with you at this time and allow them to call out your names and welcome you to the webinar. All right. Thank you for being here once again. It's great seeing so many of you from St. Martin and all around the world. I am Dr. Erna Mae Francis Cotton, the chair and developer of Grace Hill Bible University's Counseling Degree Program for the St. Martin campus. Tonight, you're in for a special treat, as apart from our capable students, we'll be sharing very vital keys for succeeding in your marriage or relationship. We have a specially invited guest who will open up with a word of prayer, briefly share with us the mission and vision of Grace Hill Bible University, as well as provide a word of exhortation to our students and you, our attentive audience. Allow me to introduce our special guest to you, Dr. Veronica Ambrews, the wife of Grace Hill Bible University's president and founder, Dr. Aldansa Ambrose. Dr. Veronica Ambrose epitomizes integrity, hard work, and creative service in every aspect of her life. An ordained elder, she's devoted to God and is presently the pastor of Abundant Grace Worship Ministries and president of the Women's Ministry, where her husband, Dr. Aldansa Ambrose, serves as the bishop. She's actively involved as an educator at Battle Hill Elementary School, Union, New Jersey, and is a vice president for Grace Hill Bible University. Dr. Ambrose believes that quality education has played a major role in her life and sees it as an empowerment to being successful. A proud mother and grandmother, born and raised in the island of Jamaica, she migrated to the United States, where she lives in Plainfield, New Jersey. Her bicultural background and focus on education is the passport of many wonderful possibilities, she says, and has opened doors to a number of volunteer opportunities. With a deep passion for education, she pursued and received her Bachelor of Arts in Education at Keene University. Not surprisingly, while attending Keene University, Dr. Ambrose served as president for the Kappa Delta Pi International Honor Society in Education for 2 years, received excellent grades, and graduated with a summa cum laude in her bachelor's degree. Additionally, Dr. Ambrose received a master's in elementary reading and literacy at Walden University. Having an unquenchable appetite to study the Word of God, she received her bachelor's, master's, and doctorate degrees in theology, as well as her PhD at Grace Hill Bible University. She was honored as Teacher of the Year and also honored by the Greater Central Jersey Clergy Association for her contribution in ministry as church administrator, secretary, deaconess, Sunday school superintendent, head usher, and youth president. Dr. Ambrose is also a founding board member of Crest Haven Academy Charter School. She's a firm believer in giving back and is particularly passionate about education. She volunteers in teaching and or donating materials for Vacation Bible School at Flankers Open Bible Church. She's actively involved in Montego Bay High School for Girls Alumni Association, New York chapter, where she serves as a chaplain for the organization, as well as participates in many community outreach projects. And with no further ado, I'd like to take this opportunity to welcome to our virtual stage, Dr. Ambrose. Welcome, Dr. Ambrose.
Thank you so very much for that warm introduction and that very warm welcome.
You're so welcome.
And I just want to say it is indeed an honor and a privilege to be on this platform this afternoon. And I am looking forward to exciting times and great information.
Awesome. So you can take it away.
Amen. At this time, we're going to pray. Almighty God, we thank you, Lord God, for this day. This is a day that you have made, Lord God, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Father God, we thank you, Lord God, for this opportunity, mighty God, where, Lord God, your children can come and show forth, mighty God, what they have learned. Father, in the mighty name of Jesus, we thank you, Lord God, for the information, Lord God, that will be spread near and far, mighty God, to help marriages, mighty God. And Father, even on today, thank you, Lord God, for strengthening them, mighty God, giving them the boldness to speak as you have placed it in their hearts. Father, we thank you, Lord God, for the director, mighty God, Dr. Nicole Ernemay Francis Cotton. Mighty God, continue to strengthen her, Lord God. And Father God, I thank you, Lord God, for the fire, for the passion, mighty God, that you have placed within her, mighty God, for counseling. Father, we give you glory, honor, and praise in Jesus' mighty name. And we say amen.
Amen.
First, I would like to bring you greetings from our president, Dr. Aldansa C. Ambrose, who is not able to be with us at this moment because of circumstances. But nevertheless, Grace Hill Bible University in New Jersey and from the head office, from the headquarters, is well represented today. So he just wants to say congratulations for this milestone. And he would also like to say to you, continue to do the hard work and keep it up. I would just like to say we are proud of you. You are champions on the St. Martin campus. You are also an example and have demonstrated how access to excellent education can change the trajectory of a person's life. Grace Hill Bible College was authorized by the state of New Jersey in 2005. And in 2012, Grace Hill Bible College was granted the status of Grace Hill Bible University, which is authorized also by the state of New Jersey to educate and equip men and women for Christian living and Christian service in all levels of degrees, all from associates all the way to PhD in various disciplines, which include but not limited to theology, ministry, Christian education, and Christian counseling, just to name some. Grace Hill Bible University is accredited by Global Accreditation for Biblical Institution, which is based in the state of New Jersey. Today, Grace Hill Bible University continues to be dedicated to biblical academic excellence for everyone. I know that our students have benefited from the world-class instruction that they received, and you are recipients of such instructions. Hence, you're here today on this platform. My heart, as I speak, is overflowing with joy unspeakable for this milestone that you have reached, despite the numerous challenges I am sure that you have faced. Your tenacity to get to this point speaks to your character and integrity. To the director, Dr. Nicole Ernemay Francis Cotton, I must commend you on the great work and tireless dedication that you have accomplished as you put Christ at the forefront of this campus. Your hard work, dedication, passion, and commitment is demonstrated through the students' milestone today. We thank you and keep up the good work. Students, you can do all things through Christ which strengthens you. He says in his word, "For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord, plans to prosper you and not to harm you, plans to give you a hope and a future." Jeremiah 29:11. You have reached this major milestone in your life. Today is just a partial payday for all the days, the weeks, the months, and years that you have worked so hard. The classes, the long nights of study, the endless and sometimes tedious lectures, the thousands of pages of reading, hundreds of pages of writing, and to have the discipline of completing your assignments on time. Today, I want you to think about that diploma that you will be receiving in your hands in the future. You might say, or some people might say, oh, it's just the paper. But to you, what does it signify? To us at Grace Hill Bible University, it celebrates discipline. It celebrates work. It celebrates perseverance. It celebrates achievement. And it celebrates success. You're right there, close to the finish line. Make it count. Leave a mark wherever you go. Build a name for yourself according to the will of God. Dream your dreams. Dream big. You're under an open heaven. Maybe you have maybe your dream is to have your own practice. But above all, make a name the world remembers. Make a name so that every life you touch, they will remember you. Every moment you get, point him only Jesus. Point to Jesus only. So let not your heart be troubled. Let your heart be merry. Thank God that he brought you to Grace Hill Bible University, St. Martin Campus, and his grace and the many doors that he has opened for you and the many doors that he still has to open for you by being here. I encourage you today, keep your focus. Put your hand to the plow of God's work for your life. You are being educated and equipped for service, your God-given assignment. You have already started to write your own history. Choice by choice, the choices that you have made, decision by decision. Let your history glorify God and someday be worth reading. Add prayer. Add solid people in your circle and perseverance as you prepare to saturate the world with the good news. We here in New Jersey at the headquarters, we are constantly praying for you, especially in this season. And we are proud of you. So I encourage you today, never give up. Hold on. Never give in. When the battle gets challenging, never, never give in. You will not quit. You are not a quitter. That's not a word in your vocabulary. When the road looks long, don't take a shortcut or an easy way out. There are no shortcuts to any place worth going. Persevere through the dark days and nights. Be assured that God will never leave you nor forsake you. Keep writing that history and make it worth reading. Keep praying and thus staying fueled for life. Keep ministering to people using the tools and the strategies you have been given, and then persevere to the finish line. The president of the university, and you notice, I mean, the president of the universe, not the president of the university, not the president of the United States, but the president of the university, God Almighty himself. He is already standing ready to present you with a diploma stamped with the words, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." Stand strong, stand firm, square your shoulders, put your plow to the wheel, and you walk with your head upright. For God you live, for God you die. He called you for this assignment, and you will see the finish line and receive that diploma from the president of the universe. God bless you this evening.
Wow. Thank you so much, Dr. Ambrose, for that electrifying message to all of us. And we sincerely appreciate what you have shared. And it has, I'm sure it has touched the students at their core, because it has been a challenging semester for them. And I'm sure that they were encouraged. And even those who were not part of the course, I'm sure that they also were encouraged. So thank you once again for that message, and we receive it wholeheartedly. So for those of you who are just joining us, I am Dr. Erna Mae Frances Cotton, and I'm going to present to you what this institution in terms of the counseling degree program is all about. So who am I and why do I qualify to be able to develop and teach a master's level counseling degree program? Well, I graduated with honors from the University of Tampa in 1995 with a BA in psychology. I earned a master's in counseling with emphasis in marriage and family therapy from the Oral Roberts University in 2000. I'm a certified success coach with the International Coaching Federation, a certified lifestyle prescriptions health coach, a certified holistic health coach, co-developer of the University of the West Indies online master's degree in social works grief course, and an emotional freedom techniques practitioner. I also obtained specialized certification in trauma therapy. In short, I'm a master therapist who helps my clients achieve stellar results. Several years ago, I was asked by the Dean of Grace Hill Bible University to teach a biblical psychology class. And while preparing to teach that class, I did some soul searching and admitted to myself, too many people in our societies are emotionally, psychologically, relationally, and spiritually challenged. As a result, our families and communities are experiencing dysfunctional and unhealthy relationships. I determined that if I am truly to help our students make an impact on our island and the world, they must be equipped to meet people where they hurt most and have the necessary skill set and mindset to transform their lives. Consequently, I set out to design and develop Grace Hill Bible U St. Martin Campus's counseling degree program. And I'm delighted to share that we've had our first group of pioneers who graduated in 2019. Since 2020, with the advent of COVID-19, we have been offering our classes online through our virtual classroom, complements of Victorious Living Foundation, the organization of which I'm the visionary. Therefore, anyone from around the world is able to access our courses. We provide the layperson, minister, or curious individual with the fundamentals of Christian counseling to be able to address the growing needs and challenges in our societies. Our courses include the fundamentals of biblical psychology, Christian counseling from an African indigenous perspective, utilizing energy psychology in counseling, theories of counseling, effective counseling techniques for working with children, the fundamentals of effective marriage counseling, which we are presenting this evening, suicide assessment, prevention and treatment, spouse abuse, a treatment program for couples, which will be held next semester, effective grief counseling, counseling ethics and counseling practicum, one semester, and a counseling internship, 3 semesters, and several electives, including active listening, business writing that works, public speaking, speaking under pressure, and creating a workplace wellness program. This semester, our deep dive focus has been the fundamentals of effective marriage counseling. As we experience ramifications of the pandemic and how it impacts people's mental health, finances, and relationships, this course is a timely solution for couples and families struggling in these trying times. Consequently, many couples and marriages are under attack as they try to make ends meet and navigate these challenging times. I'm therefore pleased to introduce our students this evening, who will present a short overview of some of the material they have learned this semester. As I said before, next semester, our focus will be on spouse abuse, a treatment program for couples. If you're interested in enrolling in this course, please feel free to send me an email at victoriouslivingsxm@gmail.com or call us at 1-721-524-8731. This evening, it is my distinct pleasure to introduce you to our counseling degree students. And these are Minerva P. Warner Hughes, born on the lovely island of St. Martin. She has been a hospitality professional for over 20 years. She loves the Lord and counts it a privilege to serve him and be of service to his people. Her quest to serve has now resulted in her pursuing her counseling degree at the Grace Hill Bible University, St. Martin campus. Next, Minister Rosanna Simona Ajide, an ordained minister and prophetess. She's a survivor, an overcomer, and a victor of multiple childhood abuse. She's passionate about education, healing the broken, and building healthy families in the kingdom of God. She's in her third year in pursuit of her master's in Christian counseling. Toya Joseph, also in her third year, was born on the island of Dominica, but has resided on St. Martin for many years. She is an anointed prayer warrior and author of Testimony of a Woman Scorned, in which she shares her powerful life story. Be sure to ask her how you may purchase your copy. Joining us for the first time is George Richardson, the eldest of 7 siblings, was born on the northern side of St. Martin. He's an electrician by profession and has been employed at NVGBE, our utility company, for the past 30 years. He gave his life to Christ in 1998. He heard about the Grace Hill Bible University through a friend and was eager to become a pastor. After sitting down with the dean, Dr. Orlando Wilson, to discuss this course of study, he came across a marriage counseling degree program, which caused his heart to light up. Consequently, he enrolled in the counseling degree program and is in his first semester. Suzanne Joyce Richards Chambers was born in Jamaica and is a mother of 3. She attends the Church of God on Back Street, where she serves as an usher and prayer intercessor. This is her second semester enrolled at Grace Hill Bible University. These 5 dynamic students will be graded on their presentations tonight and for their preparations in executing this webinar. Therefore, do give them your support and love. You're in for a great treat tonight. So with no further ado, I present to you Grace Hill Bible University's counseling degree students as they address overcoming hurdles in marriage, building it stronger. Before they do so, I want to invite you to just stretch, reach for the skies and stretch and just do a mindful yawn. And just get yourself ready, shake your hands off, and just receive from our students this evening as I exit stage left and allow them to take over for the rest of the evening. Thank you and welcome.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Minerva. I want to welcome you to tonight's masterclass. One of the basic human needs is to love and be loved. On this quest, many have set out to find a mate, starting a relationship that would later lead to marriage. Marriage is honorable and should be nourished, protected, and well cared for. When these elements are present in a marriage, it is fulfilling and rewarding. Sadly enough, not every marriage is good or leads to a happily ever after. In some marriage, the components to make it successful are lacking for a number of reasons, causing them to deteriorate like a flower that has not been attended to. Tonight, we will be exploring together happy marriages, unhappy marriages, the causes and effect of both. We will also look into the enemies of marriage and preventive measures to safeguard your marriage. It is our intention that after we would have journeyed together in this masterclass, that we will all resolve to nourish and strengthen our marriages, thereby building sound relationship house for those of us that are married. For those that are unhappy in your marriage, we pray that the information that will be shared would cause a rededication to your union with a resolve to work on the challenging areas and make repair attempts at turning the marriage into a success. Unmarried persons, this is an opportunity to gather vital information that will have the capacity to aid in your decision-making process that will greatly impact your future. Our goal as counselors in training is for every couple to raise their love bank balances and to assist couples in divorce-proofing their marriages. Happy marriage produces healthy and happy couples who contribute to a better society. And now my colleague Simone would also give you more information.
Good evening, everyone. No relationship guide can salvage every problems in a marriage or save the marriage. Nor is it true that every match should be saved. Sometimes negativity and betrayal so consume a relationship that it has already died by the time the couple seeks support. But the right form of assistance can repair far more relationships and offer a greater degree of hope than divorce, the statistic would suggest. If people who love each other are determined to make their marriage work. One of the saddest reasons a marriage dies is that neither spouse recognizes its value until it is too late. Only after the papers have been signed, the furniture divided, separate apartments rented, or house divided, do exes realize how much they really gave up when they gave up each other. Too often a good marriage is taken for granted and not giving the nurturing and the respect it deserves and desperately needs. Some people may think that getting a divorce or lavishing in an unhappy marriage is no big deal. They may even consider it a simple fact of modern day life. But there is now plenty of evidence documenting just how harmful both divorce and an unhappy relationship can be for all involved. When a marriage goes sour, the husband and the wife are not the only ones to suffer, but the children also. What about other relatives, family members, family friends, and even the community in general? Marriage was ordained and instituted by Jehovah to be a blessing and to give glorious worship unto him. However, its meaning has changed over the years because of the many different belief systems and a misinterpretation of the scriptures. It is said that marriage is blind, but love is the eye opener. So before marriage, persons must take time to know each other, learn each other's personality, learn about each other's family histories, the goals and the dreams. This masterclass is for all, singles can take away skills to build their personal foundation, while the married couples can learn to build new skills like emotional intelligence to improve your relationships. We do trust that the keys we are about to present this evening will impact your life significantly. And now we will move on to the Gutmann's theory of the four horsemen of the apocalypse. Bear with me for a moment while I share my screen. While doing so, I just want to say thank you all for coming. It's a pleasure being here once more. Thank you to Dr. Ambrose for being here. It's awesome seeing you. Awesome seeing everyone. My apostle, Louis Ponspear. It's a wonderful, wonderful pleasure to have you guys here. The Lord bless you. Okay. Now we have the four horsemen of the apocalypse. Now this is not the horsemen of the apocalypse in Revelation. John Gutmann described four major behavior as horsemen of the apocalypse. These horsemen are dangerous horsemen in the marriage. Okay? He said not all negatives are equally corrosive, but there are four behaviors which are, and they are present in all marriages. However, how we choose to deal with the differences will result in the success or failure in our marriages. Now I'll hand you over to Toya and George, who will do a short dramatization on the first behavior.
My love, preaching was so great today.
What is so good about preaching?
What the matter, babes?
You disgust me. You mean to tell me you went to church and you did not make up the bed?
Sorry, babes. We all woke up late and tired because we were ministering to each other the entire night.
Why can't you ever remember anything? I told you 1,000 times that you are responsible for keeping the bedroom neat.
Babes, can we please discuss the matter over a hot chocolate tea or after dinner?
Why you keep putting church ahead of me? Do I come last on your list?
Babes, you are everything to me and more.
Caribbean men, you are just not benefiting me. I want out.
Babes, it has come to that.
You men are just too lazy.
Thank you, Toya and George, for that lovely dramatization on criticism. Criticism is any statement that implies that there is something globally wrong with one's spouse. Something that is probably a lasting aspect of the partner's character. Any statement that begins with "you always" or "you never" will be a criticism rather than a complaint. Criticism will naturally evoke defensiveness. The difference between complaining and criticism is very important. Making a complaint will sound like this: I am upset that all through dinner, you only talked about yourself and didn't ask me anything about my day. That hurts my feelings. This is okay, because it doesn't predict anything negative in the marital outcomes. One can add blame to make this criticism. How can you treat me like this? Don't you care about my feelings? What kind of self-centered person are you? You are always late and you never get anything right. I once heard a wife telling her husband, "You can never find a hole." What was she referring to? He was trying to put up some curtains and was having challenge see getting the hole, and she was being very negative to him. This is how bad criticism can turn into contempt, disrespect. Note, we are all very creative in our varieties of criticism. And this criticism can cause a buildup in character assassination, no more fondness, demeaning the other person, rejection, assault on the other person's personality. When one personality is under attack, the other thing to do is to dig in, entrenched, and defend oneself to the bone. The next horseman is defensiveness. I don't know why you are so upset. You were supposed to remind me so I could have gotten it.
I would like for you to take some responsibility every now and again.
What are you talking about? Don't you forget to? What about when you forget to take out the garbage last week and you forgot to recharge the lamp too?
That is not the point.
You're always picking on me. I could never do anything right.
That is not the point, my dear wife. I am simply asking you to take some responsibility when you are wrong.
What about all the good things that I have done? I never get any appreciation. Poor me. Notice, in defensiveness, one never takes responsibility for their wrong. A defensive spouse will never admit that they are wrong, and they will always blame the other spouse for somehow not preventing them from making the mistake. Now, it is their spouse's fault. Unfortunately, defensiveness usually includes denying responsibility for the problem and fuel the flames of marital conflict, because it says the other person is the culprit, the other person is the guilty one, and I didn't do anything wrong. Our third slide will show the third horseman, which is contempt. Over to you, Minister Minerva.
There is no sound, Minerva. I don't know if you want to narrate what's going on since there is no sound. So while this is going on, please narrate it and I'll continue to the next person so that we have a flow of conversation.
My apologies. It appears that technology is not working with me tonight. Basically, what is happening is the husband is saying to the wife that he had forgotten to go and pay the home insurance bill. And the wife was so upset over the fact that he forgot it. But her being upset was not only related to the forgotten bill, but she was upset on the whole, and she started to tell him how irresponsible and how worthless he is, and that she would go in and take care of it, and that is what responsible people does. So that was the skit in its entirety. Like we were saying earlier, that contempt is a statement or a nonverbal behavior that puts oneself in a higher position than one's partner. Contempt can take the form of mockery, which is a very powerful, especially when it's delivered in public, and can inflict harm. There is also a contentious facial expression, such as rolling eyes and sucking teeth and you know, that smirl what you do with your mouth. The Gottman study found that contemptuous facial expression by husband were predictive of wives' infectious illness for a 4-year period, and that lonely husbands who were married to contentious wives got physically ill more than other husbands. Now we would have the court presentation by Suzanne, which is stonewalling.
Good evening, babes. How was your day at work?
Suzanne, please unmute yourself.
Sorry, miss. Go ahead, John.
Good evening, babes. How was your day at work today?
It was same as usual, tiresome. I need some time to clear my head. How was yours?
Good. One of my colleagues bought a new car, and I was thinking, we need to change ours too. He gave me the link of how to go about it. What do you think?
Honey, we talked about this already, and my answer remains the same. We don't have enough funds for that right now.
But babe, I am trying to have a discussion with you, and you giving me the silent treatment. What are you implying?
The wife turned away and went on her phone, start texting, humming, and ignoring her husband. She continues to ignore her husband while texting. And this is one part of stonewalling.
According to John Gottman, one of the most cancerous hurdles in marriage is the four horsemen of the apocalypse, which includes stonewalling. Stonewalling often play out through the use of technology. How does this affect marriage? When used properly, technology can strengthen the relationship between a husband and wife. For example, it can help a couple stay in touch throughout the day. Advisedly, spouse also misuse technology by allowing it to, one, rob them of their valuable time together, two, bring work into the home unnecessarily, three, create distrust and even disloyalty as to create a barrier between a husband and a wife in the home. For example, wife ignoring the husband by texting on the phone. Almost everything a husband and a wife do affect each other. either positively or negatively, and this determines the feeling they have for each other. If they affect each other positively enough and avoid affecting each other too negatively, they will be in love with each other. What makes a marriage work? Friendship, commitment, communication, selflessness, consideration, and unconditional love makes marriage work. Thank you very much. This is the end of my presentation. Now I turn over to Minerva.
I will be presenting on conflicts in marriages. Every marriage is a merger of two individuals who bring their own personality, belief systems, values, dreams, and aspiration as the two blend together to become one. There is no shortage of conflicts, even in the happiest of marriages. These challenges range from minor irritants to all-out wars, yet can be summed up in two basic categories: perpetual problems, which cannot be resolved, or solvable problems. It has been proven that the majority of marital conflicts fall into this category of perpetual problems, 60% to be exact. Even after years have passed, it was noted that couples were having the same arguments. Some examples are: one spouse may want a baby while the other feels not yet ready. One spouse might be working diligently towards a particular express goal while the other is laid back towards it. These problems may seem simple compared to the unsolvable ones, but can cause a great deal of pain, and the problems are solvable problems. Simply because a problem is solvable does not mean it gets resolved. Failure to deal with a solvable problem will result in it causing extensive tension. Example of a solvable problem is forgetting to do something that both spouses agreed should have been done. Typical solvable problems are in-laws, finances, sex, housework, distraction, and even a new baby. Do not allow gridlock. Gridlock is, do not become so entrenched in your position that you refuse to budge. There are no winners in gridlock. Situations, as a matter of fact, all participants suffer some type of loss. Effect of gridlock's problems are: the conflict makes one or both partners feel rejected. When a discussion is had about a particular matter, a partner might end up feeling even more frustrated and hurt. Over time, the couple becomes disengaged from each other emotionally. Keys to managing conflict: assume that no one is right. There is no absolute reality in a marital conflict, only two subjective ones. Acceptance is crucial. Heeding advice becomes easier when one feels understood, respected, and accepted for who they are. Make sure to communicate basic acceptance to your spouse's personality. Focus on your fondness and admiration. Basically, build on your building blocks. Remind yourself of what attracted you to your spouse in the first place and ensure that he or she knows what it was that set them apart from the other suitors. Means to solve your solvable problems: soften your startup. Speak kindly to your spouse. learn to make and receive repair attempts. Soothe yourself and each other. The big C in relationship, learn to compromise. Process any grievance so they don't linger. And this would have a happy effect on your home. But it's not always happy and good lucky. There are escalated conflicts. Escalated conflicts can lead to abuse, which I will call the ugly side. We are seeing and hearing more of this, especially in these challenging times in which we live. Abuse is never okay and should not be tolerated. Both physical and verbal abuse have the potential to do irreversible damage. It is not advisable to stay in a marriage in which your will is being subjected to that of another. In such a case, a divorce is much better than an abusive relationship. This is the end of my presentation. And please receive Rosanna as she would come and share on the sound building the emotional house. Rosanna?
I'm here. It was suggested by Dr. Francis Cotton that we should give 2 minutes open floor for question and answering on what was presented thus far before I present. Any questions concerning the four horsemen of the apocalypse or conflict in marriages?
Is everyone clear? No questions, no comments, no words of encouragement, nothing? That would be a good time.
Good evening.
Good evening. Very good presentation.
So good. Hello, you're hearing me?
Appreciate it.
Hello?
Dr. Francis first, Kathleen Francis first, and then James Dunlop. So we'll allow Dr. Francis and then James Dunlop. Go ahead, please.
Good evening.
Good evening.
So far, even though I started late, I joined you guys late, I am enjoying what you have presented so far. One of the good things to know at the moment is that the problems that you are discussing is across the board. It is not unique to one location or one culture. Because as you make your presentation, I can identify with some of the simple things that in my own martial relationship that started arguments that, I mean, sometimes you could avoid. But as like one presenter said, if you have respect and the necessary, like forgiveness and so, you can solve those conflicts and avoid gridlocks, right? But then again, sometimes depending on if both parties are like, you know, sometimes you can be tired or you can be having frustration or problems at work, you can sometimes take that home. And actually what is coming out on your spouse is not actually their fault, but actually what you're taking home from what is affecting you between you and your peers or a manager at work.
Thank you, Mr. James. Appreciate it. We appreciate your contribution. Thank you so much. And I also want to acknowledge Dr. Kathleen Francis, who is also an instructor at Grace of the Bible University. Do you have your contribution as well? Okay, so we will continue as Rosanna, you can go ahead.
I believe that Dr. Ambrose raised her hand.
Go ahead, you guys are leading. Lead the way.
Okay, you may go ahead and say what you want to say, Dr. Ambrose.
So far, I think that the presentation is excellent. Also, what I really do like about it is the authenticity of the skits, that they are so real to life. It's not things that are, you just pull things out of the hat, but they are practical, where you see these things really happening with husband and wives. And in addition to that, the simple but yet effective measures on how to solve these situations. You know, and one of the things that really stand out to me is the part that says, it is better not to be in an abusive relationship. You get out of it because, you know, it can lead to many other things.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ambrose. And now we will proceed with the building of the marital house. Give me a minute while I share my screen. Good evening once again, everyone. I am Rosanna, and this evening I will be presenting on the Gottman's Sound Relationship House. To make a relationship work, couple must first build trust, love, and loyalty. The question you may be asking is, what can I do to make my relationship work successfully? The answer is, nurture your friendship in your relationship by building love maps. Maintain awareness of your partner's world. Build a cognitive room for your partner. Remember major events, each other's favorite food, movies and songs. Learn what is most important to each other. Know what each other's life goals are, as well as yours and your concerns. Emotionally intelligent couples are intimately familiar with each other's world. In knowledge, there is strength. And from this knowledge springs not only love, but a fortitude to weather marital storms. The next step is share fondness and admiration. This is the antidote for contempt. Make deposit into each other's emotional bank account. Couples who are functioning in fondness and admiration of each other are able to weather the storms of marriage. These are two of the most critical elements in a rewarding and long-lasting marriage. Happily married couples may feel driven to distraction at times by their partner's personality flaws, but they can still feel that the person they married to is worthy of respect and honor. They cherish each other, which is critical to keeping their sound relationship house intact, preventing betrayals. If fondness and admiration are completely missing, reviving this relationship is virtually impossible. Next building block is turning towards each other instead of away. Accept bids for emotional connection. Couples who turn towards each other are building mutual trust. Those who don't are likely to lose their way. Couples are always making bids for each other's attention, affection, humor, and support. A bid can be as minute as a back rub, or as significant as carrying the burden when an aging parent is ill or died. Turning towards each other is a base of trust, emotional connection, passion, and satisfying sexual life. It's like putting money in the bank, which can serve as a cushion when the time gets rough. Its next step is positive perspective. Maintain a positive perspective. When this occurs, your friendship is strong and influence is present. Wives of men who accept their influences are far less likely to be harsh with their husbands when dealing with a difficult topic in the marriage. This increases the odds to their marriage growing gloriously. When a husband accepts his wife's influence, he also strengthens their friendship. He gives her security, makes her feel needed, and improve the intimacy in the marriage. Usually, when a wife says something is wrong. Both spouses accepting influence from each other will strengthen the bond of friendship, and nothing is stronger than the bond of friendship between a couple. Manage conflict. Every marriage is a union of individuals who bring to it their own opinions, personality, and values. Some conflicts are minor, while others can seem to be overwhelmingly complex and intense. Tackle the solvable head on. Make sure your startup is soft rather than harsh. Learn the effective use of repair attempts. Repair attempt can be anything, but it is generally the spouse acting as their own therapist. They comment on the communication itself. They support and soothe each other. They express appreciation to soften their complaints. A harsh startup could sound like this. I have to tell you all the time to put the thing on the table. But why you don't put a thing on the table? I'm tired talking about that. And a soft startup can be, honey, I know that sometimes you are tired and you may forget, but I will appreciate if you can just put your dish in the sink when you finish eating. That's a soft startup, and it works for men, especially. Monitor your psychology during tense discussion for warning signs of flooding. John Gottman, in his research, noticed that when couples' conflict escalated, it was not only their words, tone, and volume that escalated. It was also their heart rates and the amount of stress hormones being secreted. This emotional flooding or diffuse psychological arousal caused the nervous system to kick into an overdrive, a sensation of feelings psychologically and physically overwhelmed. During conflicts, making it virtually impossible to have any productive problem-solving conversation. End of quote. Accept influence from your spouse in decision making. Be open to compromise. Discuss your problems. Take turn listening to each other about perpetual issues. Practice self-soothing. Keep yourself calm. It is harder for men, for a man's body to calm down after an argument more than a woman, says Gottman. Become more tolerant of each other imperfections and focus on fondness and admiration. Next, honor each other's life dreams. Make dreams come true. Find ways to make each other's life dreams come true. I'm gonna pause here to share a little story on this experience myself. A few years back, I wanted to start my own daycare and first year preschool, while my husband also wanted to start his own little business. I looked into it and I considered my husband. I said it will be easier if he could start his business first and I support him. And after that, I can see where my vision is going because I have a lot of visions. So it will be good to calm myself down and help him to make his dream come true. And it worked. He loved it. He's enjoying it. And I feel contented because at the end of the day, he is supporting me now in school. For the last 3 years, he has been supporting me. So that dream is, his dream has become the dream of the marriage. A dream can cause problem if your spouse doesn't respect it or if you keep it a secret. Happy couples are aware of each other's dream. They understand that helping each other realize their dreams is one of the goals of the marriage. Acknowledging and respecting each other's deepest, most personal hopes and dreams are keys to saving and enriching your marriage. Next, into the attic. Create shared meaning in your relationship. Build a shared sense of purpose. What is your mission or your legacy that you will leave behind? If your marriage adheres to the Gottman's first six principles, there is a good chance that your relationship is stable and happy. So what's missing? Marriage isn't just about raising children, splitting chores, and making love. It can also have a spiritual dimension, creating an inner life together, a new culture, rich with symbols and rituals and appreciation for roles and goals, like Sunday dinner out, Christmas Eve dinner at home, other special dinners at home, vacation and staycation, anniversaries and the birth of babies, preparing a certain favorite dish together, similar financial goals, share each other's hopes and aspiration. A ritual is a structured event or routine that each spouse enjoys and demands or depend upon it and reinforce their sense of togetherness. What about trust and commitment? Gottman lists 5 ways we can build trust, love, and loyalty in our relationship. One, trustworthiness, a main priority in your relationship. Secondly, act to maximize your partner's well-being. Thirdly, know that trust is built in small positive moments. Fourth, avoid negative comparison. And fifth, generate frequent thoughts of acts that cherish your partner's positive qualities and minimize your focus on their negative faults. Now that we have worked through building Gottman's marital house, it is probably very clear that there is no such thing as constructive criticism in a marriage. All criticism are painful, unlike complaints, which are defined as making specific requests for change. Practice being thankful to your spouse. Practice forgiveness towards yourself and your spouse. Acknowledge your mistakes and apologize to your spouse. The more you can imbue your relationship with a spirit of thanksgiving and graceful and the graceful presence of praise, the more profound and fulfilling your life together will be. And this is the end of my presentation. Thank you for listening. Any questions?
Wonderful, Sister Rosano. I love your presentation. It shows that the manner and way in which you have presented yourself, that you clearly understood, first of all, what you were presenting. And for some strange reason, I feel as if your presentation is more or less connecting to reality. So I love it. Wonderful presentation.
Thank you, James.
If I may add, one of the things that I like is the fact that most of the elements of the presentation were secular, right? And then coming to the end, you add the spiritual component to it. In my marital relationship, one of the things that I observed, which I had cultivated from the beginning, is that prayer works. And why does it work? In the beginning, when you standing at the altar and the priest finish his sermon and all his, you know, niceties and ice cream and chocolate, at the end, before you say you may kiss the bride, he said, what God has joined together, let no one put asunder or divide. And I know all of you can agree with me. It means that we gotta keep God in that relationship all the time. To leave God out, it's problems. Everything else in building that house that you have there for your marriage to work, it's gonna be difficult. So that's my contribution. I love your presentation.
Thank you. With God, all things are possible. And as long as we are willing to work it, it will work. And I would like to hand over now the baton to my colleague, Pioneer Josh. George. It's French. Sorry, I pronounced it incorrectly. George. Who will be presenting? No, sorry. To my colleague Toya, who will be presenting on the Love Bank.
My name again is Toya Joseph, and I present to you tonight the love bank. Everyone has an emotional need. When these needs are fulfilled, we feel a special love and connection. When our partner meets most of our needs, strong bonds and romance develop. In his book, Effective Marriage Counseling, Dr. Willard F. Harley Jr. thoroughly examines the 10 emotional needs: affection, sexual fulfillment, intimate conversations, honesty and openness, physical attention, financial support, domestic support, family commitment, admiration. You may be asking why these emotional needs are so important. The love bank refers to deposits and withdrawals of love units for all interactions we have with people. When you first started to date your spouse, the dates that left you happy were the result of the love units that were deposited into your love bank. The more your partner did that make you feel loved, appreciated, admired, respect, resulted in love deposits. When your spouse says something negative to you, you begin to feel insecure, hurt, and love units withdrawals are made. You can appear proof your marriage by making sure you meet the emotional needs of your spouse and your spouse meets your emotional needs. We can increase the love bank deposits to where it has an abundant positive value. Love is the most important word in the English language and can be the most confusing. Most religious and secular thinkers agree love plays a central role in human life. Growing up, we were told love makes the world go round. For love, we will climb mountains and endure hardships. At the heart of mankind's existence is a desire to be intimate and beloved by another. Marriage was designed to meet that need to be intimate and to be loved by another. I am convinced that keeping the emotional love bank full is as important to a marriage as maintaining the proper oil fluid is to an automobile. Running your marriage on an empty love tank may cost you even more than trying to drive your car without oil. I thank you and has come to the end of my presentation, and I await your questions.
Thank you, Toya. Any questions for Toya as well as for Minerva in her presentation? Because both of them, if you had any questions for them both, since you have asked questions of Rosanna. Okay, since there are no questions, Let's go on to the next.
Next, I present my colleague, George, who will explain couples therapy. George.
Thank you, Toya. Couples therapy. These are the characteristics of a happy couple, which are foundation of affection and friendship, validation sequences, ability to resolve disagreements, positive sentiment, disagreements, a 5-to-1 or better complement criticism ratio is optimal, and amount of conflict relatively unimportant. I am going to elaborate a little bit on the validation sequences. Validation sequences is recognizing and accepting your spouse's thoughts, feelings, and behaviors as understandable. And what about positive sentiment disagreement? Positive sentiment disagreement is healthy because partners will get the opportunity or the chance to work on their problems in a positive way in their relationship. A 5-to-1 or better complement criticism always puts the most of the compliment ahead of your criticism. Couples or goals for therapy. Which are help partners negotiate behavior change, teach more effective communication skills like active listening and how to argue, avoid for harassment and other forms of destructive fighting. Early in the program, you saw how mean those four husbands is in a marriage. Focus on and encourage positive sentiment override and improve communication skills. Positive sentiment override. The meaning of that is to let your partner know how you admire them and how you appreciate them for whatever they do. Whether it's a picking up the children every day, making you a cup of coffee in the morning, you should show appreciation. This was written by Dr. John Gottman by the book, The 7 Principles for Making Marriage Work. Assessment of marital distress. As a therapist or counselor, you should always assess the couples when they come into your office. So he says couples can be assessed along behavior, cognition, and affect, or their emotional health. First, understand the characteristics of unsatisfied couples, then prevent and treat dissatisfaction. Distressed couples show high rates of the four horsemen, which are defensiveness, criticism, contempt, and stonewalling. principles of effective couple therapy. As you can see by the image, how happy that couple looks. There are five principles. These principles are: change their views of relationship, modify the dysfunctional behavior, decrease emotional avoidance, improve communication, and promote strengths. Most of us are familiar with these principles. And this is written by Dr. Andrew Christensen by the book Unify Protocol for Couples Therapy. The next slide you have is couples gridlock. The image alone show you how they are not avoiding each other because of not agreeing with each other. And the meaning of this is one spouse will call the other selfish, and it will say that you are not being influenced by your spouse, which means to say whatever one spouse say to influence you to do something that is worthwhile, you disagree. I am guilty of that. I was married for 14 and a half years. And that was one of the things that I thought was normal. But because of joining this course, I found out that those things are very harmful. And that's why I'm so happy that I picked up this course. In conclusion, couples therapy helps couples to understand different marital demands and requirements and tries to resolve their problems utilizing different techniques. It is also allows couples to establish intimacy and care between each other. That is the end of my short presentation. Are there any questions? Hello?
Since no one else is asking you questions, George, I will ask you an interesting question for you. You mentioned that, you know, you were married before and now you are learning quite some things to do differently in your new marriage. What are some of those things that you are learning and have learned that's making a difference in your marriage? Because perhaps this could help some persons who are here tonight.
Thank you for that question, Dr. Cotton Francis. One of the things that I learned, especially with the four horsemen, we don't know that there was these four horsemen that can destroy marriage. But because of going through them, I found out that that was one of the things I used to do. And I could now sit with my wife and not just have her as a wife I'm married to for responsibilities and having fun, but we became good friends. The friendship grew of my understanding what marriage is all about. Yes, we do go in front of the preacher and we say our vows, but as you walk out that church, we become a different people. But this course has helped me to understand that it's more than just having a spouse to live up to responsibilities and taking care of children, or vice versa. That's what I have learned.
Thank you so much for sharing.
Any other questions? No? Thank you so much. I believe we are kind of tired. That's why no one is responding. So.
You got a note in the chat that says, I appreciate your vulnerability and honesty, George, by sharing about your experience during your past marriage. Brilliantly presented. Thank you. And that was from Roy.
Thank you, Mr. Roy Cotton. Okay.
Yes, good evening.
Good evening.
As an educator, I am extremely impressed by all of you, your presentation. And I don't want you to get despondent. I think the reasons why you're not getting many questions, you have presented your material so clearly, and everyone can relate to it. And so don't feel bad that people are not asking questions. I think you have done a tremendous job, and I want to commend all of you for a brilliant presentation. Now, George, as sometimes when I'm dealing with women and only with men and only one woman, I'll say she's the only rose among the thorns. I don't know what to call you, but I think that you have represented us very well, and I want to thank you. And what I like about you too is that you're down to earth, honest, straightforward. And when you're doing things like this, people will appreciate what you're saying because they see that you are genuine. So once again, ladies and gentlemen, you're doing a fantastic job.
Mr. Francis, I would like to thank you very much for that encouragement. I hear your voice, and now I could recall that we sat in many sessions together, and I think I gave you a lot of respect for who you are and what you have said. Thank you very much.
You're welcome.
Wonderful. Who's next?
I am.
Go ahead.
You guys have been a very good job, and hats off to the instructor. Hats off to the instructor for a job well done.
Thank and you.
Thank I'm you, Mrs. sure that
I'm sure that one soon you guys will be able to take over, because right now there are so many people who are in need of counseling and therapy and things. So you will be able to help in a great way when Dr. Cotton is overwhelmed with work. You'll be able to come in handy. So you all are doing a good job. Keep it up, and God bless you all.
Thank you so much.
And continue to build up Grace Hill University.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I think I saw Apostle Sponsberg trying to come in.
Last night, everyone. This is a wonderful experience, and it's wonderful the way they present all of the little skits and showing exactly what is taking place in homes and families, husband and between husband and wives. And I believe that as they continue their studies and they go out into the communities and begin to minister to them and counsel them, I believe that our community will change and our families will have a better perspective on life and the way to treat their spouses. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Students, go ahead and take charge of the evening. Please, go ahead.
I would like to call on Minister Rosanna to come to the agenda, give a vote of thanks.
Good evening, everyone. Once again, it's a pleasure to be here, and it has been an awesome evening. You know, during the pregnancy, especially the last month of pregnancy, for those of us who know about that, it's hard, it's tired. You just can't sleep. You don't know where to turn. You don't know what position to put yourself in, because there is no rest because of the discomfort the baby is trying to get out. But tonight we give God thanks. We give God praise. We give God glory. We give him all the honor. We are grateful that he has brought us through this semester. We are thankful for all his goodness, for his kindness and his patience towards us. We want to thank the Holy Spirit for gracing us with his presence, for always being there to encourage us and push us on and telling us, yes, you can do it, you can make it. And I know the thoughts I have for you, thoughts to prosper you, thoughts to bring you into a good, successful end. You shall not fail because you're not a failure. You know, for all those encouraging words from the Spirit of the Lord. To our spouses, to those of us who are married, we want to thank our spouses for their support during this semester. To Dr. Veronica Ambrose for gracing us this evening with her presence and timely word. You have no idea. But we do receive that word with grace. We do receive that encouragement with grace. And it is not a mistake, because all things work together for good. We know that. And when I heard that you were coming instead of Dr. Ambrose, I said, Lord, she's coming with more empathy for us. She has more feelings, not because she is a woman, but because you have graced her to be here tonight, that she is the one, the right one, to be here to encourage us and to continue, that we will continue and not to give up. To our wonderful teacher for her kindness, her grace, her patience. You guys don't have any idea, but I really do. Her kindness is beyond words. Thank you, Dr. Nicole Ernemy Francis Cotton, for being so kind to us, for being so generous to us, for being so graceful and understanding, for giving us free therapy that, you know, we would have had to pay for at times. We thank you. And may God richly, richly, richly bless you in every facet of your life. And as you have celebrated 8 years of anniversary yesterday, wedding anniversary, we salute you and we bless you and Roy for always there encouraging us and pushing something in or pulling something out from us, or even having us on your radio show. Thank you very much. To all our attendees tonight, thank you for taking time off from your busy schedule to be a part of this webinar, the ending of our journey. We are not finished yet. We have another lap to go before we close off this semester. Thank you for being here and supporting us with this. And to my fellow colleagues, Toya, Susan, James, sorry, George, Minerva, did I miss anyone? Five of us. and myself. Thank you guys for being there. Thank you for always supporting each other. Thank you for the ups and the downs. Because of that, we were able to reach this far. Thank you very much. God bless you. God bless you. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Rosanna. Much appreciated.
And now I hand you over to teacher before I give you over, before George closes us off in prayer.
All right. Thank you so much. And I am very happy that the attendees were all blessed and informed by your presentations. That's a wonderful thing. I also want to acknowledge Agnes. Agnes, thanks for joining us tonight and for being a part of our journey. And Dr. Ambrose, do you have any closing words that you'd like to share with the students and anyone else before we close off in prayer and George prays for us tonight?
I just want to say to you, like I said before, you are stalwarts. And you have already begun to write your history. Make it count. No matter what, put on spiritual blinders. Do not look to the left. Do not look to the right. Just look ahead at that paper that you are going to get at the end of this phase of your life. Because when this phase is over, you're only just beginning another chapter in your life. God bless you. You are strong and you are going to do it. Not can do it. You are doing it.
Amen.
And you're going to get there. I want to be at the end to be the anchor to get that baton and go over that line with you.
Amen. Guys.
Stay strong. We're holding up your hands here in New Jersey. So stay strong. Dr. Nicole Erna Mae Francis Cotton, the young lady with so many names, continue to do what you're doing. The students look good. You look good as well, because you are an excellent teacher. And as I said before, the passion that you have, the passion for what you do, it spills over into their life. As an educator, I know that excitement as a teacher. And when you see your students, your heart swells real big. So continue to do what you're doing. And I pray God's continued strength upon you. We here in New Jersey at headquarters, we love you. And you are continuously in our prayers. God bless you.
Thank you so much for those words. We much appreciate it. And at this time, we will open one more time before George comes. If there's anyone else with any further questions. And after George, I am going to play some of our announcements for those of you who stay on and have any further questions.
Let me say continued strength to you, ladies and gents. Do not give up, especially at this time, because the going gets tough, but the tough must keep going.
Amen.
So you got to tough it out in the name of the Lord. He gives you the strength and the courage to carry on. And it's so nice to see Brother George in the group. And I applaud you very much. And you're doing a good job. God bless you all and continue the good work. I'm sorry that I couldn't see Sister Aventurin on the platform tonight, but God is good. Continue the good works.
Thank you.
Yeah. And it's nice to see you, Dr. Veronica Ambrose. You're not seeing me, but I'm seeing you. You're hearing my voice.
Yes, nice, but I see your name, Auntie.
Yeah. Blessings to Dr. Ambrose. Amen. And the family.
Yes.
God bless. Yes. Okay.
All right.
I would like to say this evening, this was a tremendous, amazing, beautiful presentation. I enjoyed every bit of it. The students, the counseling degree students did an amazing job. I'm really, absolutely really happy to see that there is a gentleman among the ladies. And Mr. George Richardson, you did an amazing job. I felt really proud to sit back and relax and be part of the audience. And I can say once again, fantastic. God bless the work of Dr. Nicole Ernemay Francis Cotton, my lovely wife. And we thank you for the blessings, Minister Ajide. And may you continue to soar to the highest of heights. To God be the glory. It was wonderful. And I look forward to seeing more great work. Bless one and thank God for evening.
All right. Thank you so much, my dear. Appreciate that. And so we turn the floor over to Brother George.
Thank you, Dr. Francis Cotton. And I'd like to thank all those wonderful people that joined us this evening and have such encouraging words for us. Indeed, it is not easy. It was not a piece of cake or walk in the park, but I think with the perseverance that we have in a person like Dr. Cotton Francis behind us, we will get there, because she's so smooth in telling you, you can do it, and that gives us the courage. Father, we'd like to thank you very much for this evening. We thank you, Lord, that this session went through from the beginning to the end. We thank you, Lord, that we had our Wi-Fi, our electricity, everything was in place. You know that this session was important for us, oh Father God. You know that your people out there are suffering. You know that we are the ones going to be out in the field to better lives, those that are in the hurting, those that don't understand what they're into, those that are up against a force that they don't know. But we know, because we are spiritual understanding people. I want to thank you, oh Father God, for the founders of this college. For we as a people, Black people, was denied for so long of our journey to learn. And I thank God for people like Dr. Ambrose, husband and wife, that they can set us up, that we can stay from here in St. Martin and be part of a university that will be recognized, and we will be certified marriage counselors. In the name of Jesus, I declare this. I want to thank you for the patience we had among ourselves, the rough nights that we went through rehearsing and getting it together. I want to also thank you, Lord, for Dr. Cotton Francis. She has given us so many times, and it makes me emotional that she keep on telling us we will get there. She gave us a time when we had to be ready to deliver. She said, I will give you another day. Thank you, Dr. Francis Cotton. As we go our separate ways this evening, I want to say, protect us as we go through this Christmas season, oh Father God, and let us be remembered what this Christmas season is all about. And as we open the new year and start another journey, I pray that you bless us with health, strength and energy, understanding, wisdom and knowledge, and that we will succeed. Bless each and everyone and their families, and keep us all safe from this pandemic, oh Father God, for we only could ask you to help us through this tough time, this pandemic. Our children here and abroad, protect them wherever they are. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
Amen. Amen. Give God thanks. Any of the students, do you have any closing thoughts or words?
Oh.
This was quite a journey. Interesting indeed. But indeed, we give thanks. We give thanks. We have experienced much. This course, I felt stretched. I felt fought. So I know that the purpose for this class for us is great. I want to tell you, I experienced things. I really experienced a divorce that tore my heart. But in all things, we give thanks. I am grateful that we persevered. I am grateful that we didn't drop and say, you know what? I'm not doing this. Even the presentations, you put them on, you tried it and it worked, and then you put it on again and it's not working. But to God be the glory. I'm happy that we are here in this time now with all of you. I want to say thank you, thank you, thank you from the bottom of my heart. I thank everyone that pushed and never give up. This is not the time. This is not the season. It is always darkest just before daybreak. So I give thanks again. God bless every one of you.
Thank you so much, Minerva.
I want to give God thanks for helping me to overcome the hurdles this evening. I had a big challenge, panic attack kicked in and everything, but in everything, give God thanks. In the darkest part of the night means the day is coming. So my fellow pioneers, let me push forward. Don't give up. The devil is fighting, but we are stronger. God give us the power, the victory Amen. Over all obstacles.
Amen.
Yes, Amen. I also like to give thanks and praise to Heavenly Father. And what I admire most about this course is it has taught me how to be self-disciplined. Because as a mother, and you have to work, I mean, my job is very tedious. We have to stand in the sun and call customer to come into the building to get something, to purchase any item of their choice. And finishing work, you know, it's so tedious because I go to work for 9:30 and most times I come at like 7 o'clock, 7:15 home. And sometimes it could be very tedious to open up the book and to read the book and to understand what it's saying. But this course has really taught me self-discipline. To discipline myself to achieve my goal that I want. I give God thanks and I give God praise for that. And not only that, I also want to thank my colleagues as well, because all the good words and the encouragement and the laughter, you know, has really motivated me to go the extra mile. So I thank them for that.
Thank you. Thank you for that. And so I'm going to share my screen. And I want to say, Suzanne, I see that you have stepped up to the plate again, especially considering that you almost had a panic attack. So congratulations. Congratulations to all of you. You know, I am I can be a slave driver. So, you know, I always see other things, but I say overall, you have done a great job. So to God be the glory. And I am so happy that each of you has withstood the test and there's even more to go. And thank you for all attendees who have joined us tonight. We appreciate you. Thank you also, Dr. Ambrose. So with that being said, I will share my screen. And if there is anything further, I'm going to stop because if I'm having some technical issues right now, but I'm going to bid you adieu and have a wonderful night. Thank you for coming once again. Anne Marlin, Agnes Aventurin, Apostle Louise Sponsper, Dr. Veronica, Gilroy Mills, Jensen Jack, Kathleen Francis, and Mr. Oswald Francis, Roy Cotton Jr., Verna Gums, Glenda Kroonevelt. Thank you one and all for being here. And we look forward to the next term where we will also present our next course on spouse abuse, a treatment program for spouse abuse. So if there's any of you here that recognizes this is an issue that you would like to learn more about, or you know of persons who could benefit from such a training, please feel free to invite them and let them know that this will be coming up in February. So have a blessed night, everyone. Because it looks as if my my presentation decided to stop. So we will stop here for tonight. And students, if you have anyone that you want to thank otherwise, or we'll just be here for a few minutes to answer any questions, and feel free to ask any questions.
And not us, not us, but we let each other down, 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 down. Yeah, we let each other down, 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 down. This shouldn't be us. What came between us? When did we become like them? We were supposed to break up.
Professional is growing exponentially. A supportive mentor who takes the time to understand their client and helps them identify the underlying causes of their health challenges. Whether the goal is to address a specific health concern or improve overall wellness, a health coach is that new kind of health professional who motivates people to make lasting, positive changes so they can feel and be their best. Our current healthcare system does not have time to address the lifestyle causes of most people's health issues. The Institute of Holistic Health is helping to fill that healthcare industry void. IWH teaches and certifies like-minded people to become health coaches. Once certified, an IWH health coach will take the time to understand their client's needs and concerns. Coaches are trained to look at the different parts of their clients' lives and use alternative health methods to address the root causes of their issues. Health coaches also serve as personal mentors who help find the right nutrition plan for each person and guide them to adopt everyday healthy eating habits. They also plan proper nutritional supplementation and help their clients improve their mindset so they can be their best. The Institute of Holistic Health has some of the world's leading health coaches who have been helping people solve challenges for over 25 years. As an IWH health coach, you'll have access to our cutting-edge health evaluation platform that makes it easy to identify nutritional problems and recommend all-natural solutions. Our online curriculum also covers practical business training to help students launch their own health coaching business. When you're a health coach, you'll be able to help people around the world create their own healthier, longer life. The demand for health coaches is huge. Become an Institute of Holistic Health coach today.
Finished for tonight. The recording has stopped. Give yourselves a round of applause. Let me turn off my music. Suzanne, you're looking very nice.
Thank you, Miss. Thank you very much.
Okay.